everyone. Thanks very much for joining us for another in the series of Will Work for Food programs. Today is November 4th, and we have with us an esteemed guest. We have with us the former Chief of Staff for the United Nations World Food Program, Michael Stayton. Michael's going to be giving us a brief presentation as soon as Jeff and Jean give us an update about where we stand with monies raised and how those monies are applied.
Well, thank you, Natalie. Since we began our series in the spring of 2020, we've been asking people to contribute to food banks designated by our speakers or food banks that are otherwise important to them around the world. And the response of our generous audiences has been just staggering and humbling and overwhelming. And I'm so delighted to announce on behalf of our team here, Natalie, Jean, Sarah, myself, and on behalf of all of our wonderful speakers and all of our generous contributors, the audiences over these months, we are now over $200,000 that our generous audiences have contributed. 202,570 dollars have been contributed by our generous audiences in honor of our speakers. Leela Love, who presented last week, does become the answer to that trivia question: who is the speaker in whose honor the Will Work for Food project went over $200,000? Leela herself made a very generous contribution after her presentation. And so we're going to give her credit for being the person who put us over the $200,000 mark. Michael, we're looking forward to your presentation today and the presentations of many other wonderful speakers in the future. We look forward to our generous audiences continuing to contribute, fight food insecurity around the world. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you. Jean?
Well, you know, I like to do the numbers here and the math. And so here's what this translates to in terms of meals, the number of meals. You've heard me say more than 2 million meals so far. Well, using three food banks in the U.S. as an example, the major one in Texas, they're able to make 13 meals for every dollar that is donated. So that would translate to 2,633,410 meals served. In California, the West and the East, basically the big cities, the average is closer to 10 meals per dollar, which is 2,025,700 meals. The national average in the US is 8 meals per dollar. It all depends on buying power of the particular food bank. And so that translates to 1,620,560 meals that have been served. So anyway, you slice it, dice it, cut it, whatever, there have been millions of meals served thanks to the generosity of the Will Work for Food community. And I join Jeff and Natalie and Sari in saying thank you so much. That's great. And on to 250,000. So thanks.
Right. Michael Stayton, former Chief of Staff for the United Nations World Food Program. The floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, Natalie. Good morning, everybody. I'm going to cover a subject that's near and dear to my heart. I've been working in the humanitarian world for a couple of decades now, on and off. But today I'm going to try to show you the linkage between conflict and world hunger, and then indicate how the UN World Food Program has been instrumental in mitigating some of that. Unfortunately, it's too big for one organization to deal with by itself. And hopefully then bring that back at the end to show you how world hunger, conflict, and mediation are all tied together. So I have a PowerPoint presentation that I'll go through. I'm not going to read it. It's available if you want it afterwards, but we'll just use that as a guideline. So Sorry, if you want to start. So I thought I would start my presentation this morning with the notion that a picture is worth a thousand words, and in this case, a video is going to be worth that much more. So I'm going to start with a short video showing you what WFP is all about, and then come back and begin my presentation. We'll hold comments until or questions until the end. I'm very interested not only getting questions, but also any suggestions how mediation can help what we're doing at WFP. So I go ahead and start the video then. I hope you enjoy this. This is a video I put together when I was chief of staff of WFP to get private sector corporations to help us out. Very few people out in the United States know about WFP. A lot of people outside the United States do, because that's where WFP works. But so this video should be a good tutorial for you on how. Can you advance the slide, please?
I'm very sorry, something has went wrong.
Just push the page down button on your computer. Yeah. While she's working on that, a lot of people talk about world hunger, but most people really don't know what world hunger means and how prevalent and deadly it is. Here we go. So I'll be back.
The woman who would have cured AIDS died when she was three. She starved to death. The baby who would have grown to set Olympic records that would stand for generations never competed. Because her mother was so underfed, she was never born. The man who could have brought peace to the Middle East never formed the thought. His mind was dulled by malnutrition. 24,000 people a day, 18,000 of them children, dead of hunger. 800 million living on the very razor-thin edge of starvation, quietly slipping away in corners of the world that you, by accident of birth, have the good fortune of never seeing. So many possibilities, so much genius, so many lives never lived. So many of us, not them, us, people who have as much right to live as anyone else on this planet. We can't stop the floods, or the droughts, or the wars. We are not Allah, God, or anybody even close. But there is something we can do. We can be the people who stand between life and death, between hope and hunger. We are the United Nations World Food Program, the world's largest and most effective tool for feeding a hungry world. We are the people who find the food shortages and the food resources and bring them together. We are the ships and planes and warehouses and trucks who deliver the food to agencies like the Red Cross, the Red Crescent, and more than 1,100 others. We are the people who find compassionate governments willing to help, enlightened corporations willing to give. We're the people who are in the hungriest places following the shipments to make sure they get to the right people. We're also the people who make sure poor children come to school and get a chance to think about things other than where their next meal is coming from. Our mission and our reason for being is so simple, but so huge. To stop the dying and start the living. To stop the hunger and start the hoping, not just for villages of people, but nations of people. Each year, we bring food to nearly 90 million sons, daughters, mothers, and fathers in more than 80 countries. But if we are so good, why haven't we eliminated hunger from the world? Because there's no end to war, political upheaval, natural disaster, and yes, human cruelty. Fortunately, there's no end to our commitment to feed the hungry either. The World Food Program. There is no greater gift and no better way to give it.
The World Food Program.
Stamping out world hunger.
The World Food Program is mobilizing
56,000 metric tons of food at a cost of about $45 million.
Around 1.2 million children in special feeding centers.
50,000 tons of metric tons of food aid pledged by the United States. The World Food Program says 10 times that amount is needed.
Now it's only 50 miles south of the nearest town. That doesn't sound a lot, but it's completely inaccessible by road right now. And so this plane is bringing in much needed food aid. It's a giant Russian Ilyushin commandeered by the UN, the World Food Program. And any minute now, it's gonna open up. There we see it.
Getting food into West Darfur is trying to squeeze a watermelon through a keyhole because the infrastructure is so small, the airport is small. It's difficult to get food in there, especially during the rainy season.
It takes about 2 days from New York into Chad.
We are currently heading to one of the warehouses for the World Food Program. We're going to see both their storage facilities and kind of get more of a grasp on how exactly they manage, you know, feeding hundreds of thousands of refugees here in Chad.
This truck here would have come up from Cameroon. It's brought probably about 20 tons of food.
As the winter's looming, what's making it more difficult?
This is actually the most difficult physical humanitarian crisis we've ever faced.
Why?
Well, because of the very tough terrain. It's mountainous, as your weather reporter just suggested. The snow is forthcoming. It's a serious problem. Landslides have made it almost impossible to penetrate. We've been relying heavily both on helicopters and mules and horses to get our food to people who need it. And I suspect there's still a couple hundred thousand people that need help.
Nisar's team are known as the Quake Jumpers, employed by the World Food Program to scour vast mountainous areas in search of communities not yet touched by the relief effort.
Jordan Day from the World Food Program. And how is your work going on the island? Have you getting out to those remote areas?
Well, it's definitely picking up. It's getting easier to get around and get out to some of the outlying areas, but we are concerned about the most remote, most isolated areas.
These people, though, will need help for years to come, underscoring the importance of the UN's billion-dollar appeal.
The main priority is still on food, and it is getting it into these remote locations that's going to cost so much. So that's why the appeal is quite hefty. But as you've seen, these communities have absolutely nothing.
From an early age, he dreamt of running a big company. Now Peter Bakker has got his wish. Today on Benjamin's Boardroom, the chief executive of mail and logistics group TNT talks to me about leadership, ambition, and TNT support for the World Food Program.
And you run your Fighting Hunger campaign just like a business. You're contributing about 10 million euros a year to Fighting Hunger.
Yep, correct. And that is 1 million of that is cash donations. 9 million is our skills, our people, our resources. Sometimes we fly our planes. So we're really serious about what can our skills do, and our skills are in our people. What can our people do to help the World Food Program take on the fight against hunger?
So when Lauren Bush, Princeton student, elite model, and niece to the president, George W. Bush, was asked to be the honorary spokesperson for the World Food Program, she immediately accepted and got to work.
It has just been the most amazing opportunity to get to go and travel and really feel connected to these people that I'm trying to help. I've been so honored that they asked me to be a part of this.
There is no greater gift and no better way to give it than to the World Food Program.
If thank you. Sorry, you can go ahead and advance the slide. So that gives you a short view of some of the work that WFP has done historically, and some of those clips are dated. Unfortunately, the world's problems are bigger than they were back then. But before I go on, I'd like to put in context what world hunger really is. Because as I said, a lot of people talk about world hunger, but they really don't know how deadly it can be. So currently, there are over 800 million people that will go to bed hungry tonight around the world. Most of those are women and children, and world hunger is more deadly than any of the wars that we've had historically. Slide, please. To put that in perspective, of the 800 million people that go to bed hungry tonight, about a third, 270 million, are literally facing starvation. Now, the significance of that number is that it's doubled in the last 2 years since COVID, because the world has been working very hard at driving that number down, got it down below 200 million, and now it's back up to 270 due to COVID. That translates into 25,000 people dying every day of starvation. And more unfortunately, 18,000 of those are children. A child will slip away quietly from malnutrition and starvation every 5 seconds today. So when you put in perspective world hunger to our current issue, which is COVID-19, so far in the last 2 years with COVID-19, we've had a little over 5 million deaths around the world, compared to 9 million every year that are dying of world hunger. So unfortunately, world hunger is a lot bigger than COVID-19. Slide, please. Where is world hunger today? This is a slide from the WFP's website. They maintain a world hunger map, and this is kept up to date for a number of parameters, not only hunger, but I'm going to show you how that correlates with conflict, which is the premise of my talk this morning. But you can see that world hunger is prevalent basically in three continents: Africa, Asia, and South America. Now, if I overlay, now remember what the slide looks like, because in the next slide, go ahead, sorry. If I overlay conflict today, and this is another slide from the same interactive database that WFP maintains, you can see that the direct conflict right now around the world is essentially in the same places as world hunger. And so these are two issues. Conflict and world hunger are so intertwined that they really can't be separated. And you'll see later on that, you know, that could be a chicken or an egg a situation, which comes first, world hunger or conflict. But I hope to shed a little bit of light on that yet this morning. Slide, please, sorry. So what does conflict have to do with world hunger? It really is, food security is essential to peace, and vice versa. Going back to that overlay slot, two sets of slides that I showed you, 60% of world hunger is located in those active conflict zones. Slide, please. But the real number is, of the 800 million people facing hunger, 90% are in conflict zones if I exclude China and India, where there isn't really conflict. So the direct correlation is so evident that working on both at the same time is essential. Slide, please. Today, of those 270 million people facing famine, the key areas are these, and these are the ones that you've read about in the paper, see on television, heard about, maybe all of them, maybe except with the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo, have been on the news over the past couple of years. And I'm going to touch base on each of one of these as we move forward. But I just wanted to show you that at this point in time, 22 million people in Afghanistan, for example, are facing famine as the winter approaches. Slide, please. So I'm going to talk a little bit about WFP and how it is, its job has been to mitigate world hunger and how that has contributed to reducing conflict. And then I'm going to circle back and see how that interacts with mediation, which is what you all do. Slide, please. You may ask, what is WFP? Well, it unfortunately has grown into the world's largest humanitarian organization. It was formed in 1963 during the JFK administration to be the first responder to tragedies around the world, whether they be from war or from natural disasters. So it's been around for 50 years. WFP is headquartered in Rome with over 20,000 employees around the world. Last year dealt with 115 million beneficiaries. This year it's gonna be closer to 150 million people as things have gotten worse due to COVID and the conflict has continued to increase. Next slide, please. So what is WFP's mandate as a first responder? Well, it's to deal with the most critical starvation cases in the world. And basically it tries to get to the 15% of the 800 million that are hungry. That's all the Western world is where the funding comes from. And it turns out that only about 15% of the people can actually be addressed. So those are the lives that are being saved every year, thousands and millions of them in that 15%. WFP also has the responsibility for setting up humanitarian communications in all situations, whether it be war or natural disasters around the world, and it handles all of UN's logistics during emergencies. Next slide, please. WFP was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize last year in recognition of all the work that it's been doing. It's been doing this for 50 years, but it got formal recognition last year for its work, and it was clearly linked to the peace that it contributed to over that time frame. So it just wasn't the fact that WFP in 2020 all of a sudden was helpful to the world's peace. It's been going on for 50 years, and unfortunately it's been growing rather than shrinking. When I was there, I've always felt that our job was to put WFP out of business because the world would be a better place. Unfortunately, it's getting bigger, which is an indicator that maybe the world's not getting to be a better place. Next slide, please. So I'm gonna show you a few examples of WFP and conflict past and present. And I'm just gonna show you a couple of major historical ones of the hundreds of interventions that WFP has contributed to peace and over the past 50 years. Next slide. The first example is in North Korea. A lot of Americans probably don't even realize, or people around the world don't realize, that the United States and the UN has been helping North Korea since the late 90s. In 1997, there was a famine in North Korea, and the United States, South Korea, and Japan came together in a coalition to mitigate that famine and provided enough support in North Korea to feed entire third of the nation. WFP has been the sole international organization in North Korea since 1997 and is still dealing with feeding North Koreans, as the regime there tends to spend more money on its armament, nuclear program, and other things. In the intervening time period, it's interesting that both South Korea and Japan have dropped out of the coalition, and the United States had to make a decision whether or not to keep the support going, which it has up until this day. And why is that? As at the same time, the United States is negotiating with North Korea on nuclear dearmament, why provide the food aid? Well, the important point is that they don't want civil unrest in North Korea. And making sure there's food security there is an underlying bedrock foundation of making sure that at least from that standpoint, there's no civil unrest. So it gives you an example of how food security can provide a foundation for difficult situations. It doesn't solve the problem, and I'll come to that later about mediation, but I think that it at least provides a decent foundation. Next slide, please. This next example is even larger, and took place from 2003 to 2005, when the Western world, led by the United States and Great Britain, decided to invade Iraq in 2003, in March of 2003, to eliminate Saddam Hussein's regime. They contacted us at the World Food Program about 3 months before and said they were going to do this. But they knew that once the regime fell, there would be a huge vacuum there, and that there would be millions of Iraqis that would starve to death in the turmoil that was created by the invasion, but also the aftermath. And they wanted a level playing field to start rebuilding Iraq, and hopefully the aspiration back then was a democracy, and that didn't turn out. But at least they knew that if the people were food insecure, that they would have little chance of being successful. So they asked us to feed the entire country for 2 years, which we did, 27 million Iraqis for 2 years, to provide a firm foundation for peaceful discussions and negotiations. Next slide, please. Now, fast forwarding to where we are today, here's where this year WFP's major operations are, and there's no coincidence that they're in those very places that I showed you on the previous slide, with the addition of the overlay of the COVID pandemic, which WFP has also been asked to participate in. Next slide, please, sorry. And I'm just re-showing you that same slide just to show that the correlation is directly there. Next slide, please. I'm not going to talk about all of these hotspots, but I do want to talk about Afghanistan, since it's the most current and largest situation in the world right now, arguably, and what's going on there. But since this summer, when the United States departed and the Taliban took control of the country, I was in Rome in September, attending an emergency board meeting that WFP was having to deal with the aftermath of the US leaving and the current regime coming in and what was going to be needed to support the country. And at that point in time, the country director, who by the way is a woman, an Irish woman working in Afghanistan on behalf of WFP running their operation there. We've been there since for 20 years, but nothing like what's needed now with the Taliban running it. The estimate back then was that 17 million Afghanis would be in jeopardy of starvation by the end of the year as the winter came on, for a couple of reasons. One was the fact that there has been a drought there for 2 years running, so the crops are very lean and there's nothing in the marketplaces. And then secondly, with the change of the regime there and the Taliban taking over, and the Taliban essentially being cut off by the Western world from the banking community, liquidity is zero there. And so that has made the situation more acute. And now the estimate's up to 22 million Afghanis could be at risk of starvation over the next 6 months, 3 million children by the end of the year. So this emergency board meeting was set up to be an appeal to the Western world that WFP would need $200 million to take care of the Afghanis between now and the end of the year, and another $200 million for the first quarter of next year to prevent famine in Afghanistan. They put that in perspective that it's not a large number. $400 million is not a large number in Afghanistan when the number to conduct war in Afghanistan historically over the last 20 years has been $200 million a day. Let me reemphasize that. $200 million a day is what the conflict in Afghanistan has cost the world. And so $200 million over the next 3 months and another $200 million the following 3 months is a drop in the bucket to that. And that was, well, hopefully we'll be able to raise that. These pictures that I show you of these operations are current. These are all pictures taken by WFP personnel this year. So these aren't historical pictures. This is what's actually going on. Next slide, please. I'm not going to touch much on the Syria civil war. You all know about that. It's been going on for 7 years. WFP has been there trying to provide interventions within Syria. It's been very difficult at times because the government has limited humanitarian intervention and access. And that's a place that I believe that mediation can really come into play. And I'll touch on that in a little bit later. But there were also, in addition to what WFP is doing within Syria, they're also helping 7 million refugees that have left Syria in the surrounding countries because of the conflict. And so hopefully they'll be able to go home someday if it ever gets resolved. Next slide, please. I'm just gonna run through these next few pictures very quickly. This is just really for your benefit. The Yemen conflict, unfortunately, is a conflict created essentially between Iran and Saudi Arabia, and Yemen's right in the middle of it. And it's arguably one of the worst humanitarian situations in the world right now. Next conflict, next slide, please. This next one, most people don't really know about, and it probably has the largest number of people at risk for starvation in the world today, and that's the Democratic Republic of Congo. It's essentially been in civil war for 3 decades, and it's that hasn't ended. 27 million people are at risk at this point in time that WFP is helping there. Next slide, please. You've probably read about this recently in the paper, where the folks in Tigray have risen up against the Ethiopian government due to food insecurity and other civil unrest matters. And they need a lot of help in Ethiopia getting this solved, but starting with food security will be important. Next slide, please. In addition to, in South Sudan, there's been a civil war going on there for the last 5 years. After South Sudan seceded from their larger parent, Sudan, 10 years ago, they've been in civil war, and there's a major humanitarian crisis going on there as well. A lot of peace negotiations going on, and WFP's been trying to make sure that the food security is not an issue so that those negotiations can continue. Next slide, please. Now, moving from conflict to COVID-19, as I indicated, those facing starvation, the number is essentially double with the COVID overlay and what that's created. WFP has been called on by the Western world to help with that in third world countries. And here are a couple of examples. On the left, there's a center that was set up in East Timor in Asia to provide testing and then now vaccinations that WFP is maintaining on behalf of the government. The right-hand slide is a shot in Miramar, and it's a cash distribution site that WFP runs for people that are unemployed due to COVID, just like we have the unemployment supplement here in the United States. Why WFP? Well, WFP runs the largest cash distribution system network outside the developed world, because years ago, we figured out that it's a lot cheaper to move cash around electronically than it is to ship food. So in those countries that have actual markets where food can be purchased rather than imported, it's a lot more efficient to import cash. So WFP worked with MasterCard to develop this worldwide system, which has turned out to be a perfect system to help with the COVID pandemic as well. Next slide, please. Closer to home here in the United States, the Haiti earthquake this year has disrupted a country that is weak to begin with. And as you've read in the paper, there's been a recent coup as a result of the unrest there. And part of that is the food insecurity. Next slide, please. I could go on and on, but I'm not. I'd like to cover a couple of long-term, before I get to mediation, a couple of long-term interventions for peace in the world. And that is first, mother and child malnutrition programs across the globe that WFP manages. A 5-year period from inception to 4 years old for children is the most critical growth period for a child's brain of their entire life. And if a child is malnourished during that 5-year period, no matter how well they eat after age four. They'll never catch up mentally with their peers. So making sure that interventions are available, therapeutic feeding interventions are available to children that need it during that five-year period is paramount in the long-term view of making sure there's food security and hopefully more peaceful situations and help lift these countries out of poverty. Next slide, please. And nutrition, therapeutic nutrition does work. Here is a graphic example from DRC when I was there of a nine-year-old boy. First of all, he doesn't look 9 years old because he's stunted, but he was on his deathbed. But two months of therapeutic feeding intervention, he became a thriving young little boy. He'll never catch up. He will always be stunted, but at least his life was saved. Next slide, please. The other long-term view on food security and peacemaking is making sure that kids get fed when they're in school. This is no surprise. The United States started doing this after World War II when it mandated that all school systems within the U.S. provide hot lunches. And so WFP is currently feeding 18 million children around the world in schools that can't provide hot lunches at this point in time. Next slide, please. How does WFP pay for all of this? Well, it's 100% voluntary donations mostly from the developed countries' governments. You can see last year that WFP actually raised $8.5 billion. The United States was the largest donor last year, and it historically has provided over 40% of WFP's support. WFP will need, last year needed twice that amount to do what it really needed to do. It typically gets about half what it needs, and that's why it's limited to the most critical 15%. But this number will be well over $10 billion this year between what's going on in Afghanistan, the Middle East, and COVID. So it's a big number each year and continues to grow. Next slide, please. So that's what WFP and World Hunger are all about. What does this have to do with mediation? Well, I would suggest to you that that food security is an important component of peace building, but it's not the solution. It can provide what I would call a level playing field for proper negotiations or mediation to happen, but in the absence of food security, it makes mediation very difficult to be successful. In my experience, mediation is needed from very small needs at the local level. I mean, let's take Syria, for example, negotiating access to one of their villages with the government. I mean, it could be a small mediation as that, or it could be worldwide and big, like when Bill Clinton, when he was president, was trying to mediate personally the conflict between Israel and Palestine. So my point is that while food security is important and it's directly linked to conflict, I would suggest to you that mediation is really the tool that gets it across the goal line. And I'm very interested. I'm a humanitarian. I've been dealing with this for 20 years, but I'm not a mediator. And so I'd be interested, in addition to questions today about my presentation, if anybody has any suggestions on how mediation can help with what's going on in the world, I would certainly appreciate it. Next slide, please. I'm going to leave you with a little uplifting video, and then we'll go for questions.
Listen, baby, ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me, no matter where you are, no matter how far.
Don't worry, baby,
just call my name, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry, 'cause baby, there ain't no
Next slide, please. Thank you, everybody, for listening this morning. I'd entertain questions if you have some.
Well, Michael, that was a truly extraordinary presentation, really eye-opening. I know that I, for one, had no idea about the World Food Program, and I assume that others online didn't know much or anything about it either. So you've really done us a tremendous service by sharing this fantastic information about your own career and your own life and the good work you've done and the good work done by this program. It's really extraordinary. We have a lot of questions. Let me start with one from Kim Best. Kim asks, what is it like for the folks actually going into these high conflict places, going into places like North Korea or Afghanistan? I assume that for the United States citizens, the Department of State would probably tell us it's not such a hot idea to go to a place like Afghanistan or North Korea. What is the actual experience of people who go there?
That's a great question. And it varies, but it's typically high risk. There's no question about that. If you're going into a place like Syria where there's an active conflict going on is one thing, and our people have restricted areas where that they can go, and we have security forces that help us keep our people secure. But making sure that our people have access, humanitarian access to those that need it, is typically done at the table with the local authorities, whether it be the Taliban or the Syrian government or the North Korean regime, to make sure that they agree with, in exchange for access, that we will take care of their people. And that is a mediation. That is not every one of them is a single mediation every time and they get broken, just like peace treaties get broken, and we will have to work very hard to protect our people. But more importantly, our people are willing to do that to make sure that the beneficiaries they get to don't die. So it's 20,000 remarkable people working for the organization, but I think it's important from a mediation standpoint that there are, through the UN and through third party governments that want to broker or mediate a peace settlement in a particular area, that we're always looking for expertise in mediation. And as I say, either at the local level or all the way up to the national and international level. So I think that to the extent that the mediation community can work with existing mechanisms to help, it will go a long way in reaching world peace, in addition to the ancillary benefit of improving world hunger.
Do you have some concrete suggestions, Michael, as to how that could happen, how mediators can contribute to these good causes?
Well, that's a fair question. I will tell you that I do know that Mediators Beyond Borders is talking with the United Nations about helping the UN. And I mean, that's basically what the UN is all about, right? International peace and things like that. So that's at a very large level. But I think that if people are located outside the United States, and so my understanding that you're will work for food audience is all around the world. I think working with, if you're interested in a particular conflict or situation that is a difficult situation, doesn't necessarily need to be conflict, is to contact directly the one of the parties and see if they can get you in into the tent, so to speak. Because I think that that's clearly governments talking to governments, if they have issues, doesn't work without third-party mediation. So people offering to help that and coming to them, I think, is extremely important, because they're not going to reach out, I don't think. I mean, I just, that's my personal opinion. But so the more that can be done to approach situations in which somebody might be interested in, that's already there from a humanitarian standpoint, would allow that to happen.
So what, obviously we're not just going to get on a plane and go to Afghanistan and show up. But what would somebody do? How would you, who would you, what would you do?
Well, so when I contacted, well, I'll give you an example, Jeff. When I contacted MBVI to see if I could be helpful in getting the UN and MBVI working together, it was important to me to know where the mediation expertise was. And in particular, for example, the WFP's headquartered in Rome, right? And so having access to mediators, professional mediators in Europe, and knowing where they are and who they are, would allow the executive management in Rome to contact them and say, we need some help here, X, Y, and Z. And that's how it would really happen. So I think that you're right. You're just not going to buy a plane ticket to Afghanistan. But if the parties that are dealing with it, and right now, Afghanistan, you can't contact the State Department because we ain't there right now, correct? So, and you're not going to call up the Taliban and throw your name into the hat unless you have access to that network. So I think that for now, the world is trying to figure out how to deal with this, with the new government there, since there aren't any ambassadors that are part of the Taliban at this point in time. But the best way would be to contact an embassy in the country that you're interested in, and then allow the embassy to work with you if you wanted access into a country to help.
Michael, let me ask one more question. Have you, in your own travels, been in any of these conflict zones and felt doubts about your own physical security at any times?
The answer is yes. I mean, I traveled to over 50 of the 80 countries, areas that when I was the active chief of staff for 5 years, and always had to have security forces with me. And in most of the countries, that burden falls on the host government to provide the security forces. But I've been in some pretty dicey places. Where I have felt insecure and
tell us about
going to get out.
We'd love to hear a story. Tell us about one.
Well, probably the, I'll tell you two stories, Jeff. The short one is when I was in Libya, when Gaddafi was still in power, we were negotiating a corridor. There was a genocide and famine going on in Chad and Western Sudan and Darfur, and we needed to negotiate a corridor for our humanitarian aid through the country of Libya across the desert. And so I was there, and it was a very uncomfortable feeling, because I was monitored by their handlers the whole time. As I was trying to get out, I think that I had to go through 6 checkpoints, and I was wondering whether at some checkpoint they were going to say, well, we're not going to let you out. So I did feel insecure there. I've been places where I've had to have armed guards outside my hotel room at night, making sure that I was secure. The most interesting one, and this may just take a second, but I was on a mission to the Horn of Africa in 2006, I think it was, because in Ethiopia, they were having problems back then, not like they are now, there was no conflict. But in northern Kenya at the time, there was the largest refugee camp in the world, 250,000 refugees, most of them from Somalia, just north of, if you know your geography in the Horn of Africa, just north of Kenya is Somalia, which is obviously a broken state and a very difficult country. And so we were, part of my mission was to see our work up there. I had been recruiting President Bush's daughter, one of his twin daughters, to come work for us, who I had met when her mother was leading the U.S. Winter Olympic delegation through Italy that year. And so I asked her to go on this mission to see if she'd be interested in working with WFP. And so after getting all the approvals at the White House to do that, and as you can imagine, they wanted to send her Secret Service detail with her as well. What I didn't realize was is that because we were going to be so close to the Somalia border, which was obviously a high terrorist activity area, they not only sent her two Secret Service agents that are her normal detail, but they also sent an entire counterinsurgency team from the Secret Service to make sure that we were safe. And so I was, we were driving around Kenya and pulling into this refugee camp with a convoy of 20 land cruisers, because I had all this Secret Service people with me, and they were unobtrusive. I mean, they disappeared, but my point is that it was serious enough, and we were in a peaceful country like Kenya, but it is very difficult. And the fact that that Washington felt so strongly about that to provide that kind of fire, if some poor group of bandits decided they wanted to attack our convoy, they would have been very surprised. But anyway, so security is essential, and WFP has lost, I've lost track of the number, 60 or 70 employees in the line of duty.
Wow. Jean, you want to pick some questions out, please?
Yeah, I'll take it from here then. Thank you. So thank you so much. This has just been, I mean, that video is incredible, and thank you for the work that you do. It's amazing. So there are a number of questions here in the chat, some more practical than others. And so let me just go through some of them for you here. First of all, does the World Food Program work with small nonprofits? And is this contact, and then how do you contact the local WFP representative in a particular country? And one in particular, one of our audience members here, one of our community, Leslie Hurtado, she is working for this in Eswatini. And they're setting up a food program for the children there. Do you have any suggestions on what to do in general, and perhaps who in Eswatini they might contact?
First of all, where is she working?
Eswatini. Leslie, do you want to speak up? No, she's not here. It's spelled E-S-W-A-T. Hold on, let me go back to this here.
East Timor?
E-S-W-A-T-I-N-I. Okay, well.
But anyway, let me give you the short answer. So okay. if somebody's interested, WFP's website shows all of the countries it works in, what interventions they are doing there at that point in time, who the country director is, and how you can contact them. And so there'll be a list of 90 countries right now. And if somebody is not, if they're not working there in a country, for example, then there's a way you can contact the headquarters in Rome to see if who's working where. But WFP typically does not like prefers not to go the last mile. They prefer to use the local NGOs and the smaller not-for-profits that are already there. WFP will go the last mile where there isn't anybody, or if it's too risky for other NGOs. They will go the last mile, but preferably they prefer to work with over 1,000 NGOs at any point in time around the world.
Okay, great. Then there are also questions about, you know, since mediators are neutral, for example, who do you use, or I mean, where do you go in the local country or the community for conflicts or whatever for mediators? And then as an industry, how can we provide more mediators, perhaps train locals, make donations, things like this? What suggestions would you have?
Okay. Well, I'm not exactly sure. What I know that MBBI has a training program it's establishing to help with that, and maybe could provide better guidance than I can. But I can tell you that, for example, if somebody was interested in helping in Ethiopia, for example, and there was a question of access for humanitarian aid, contacting the country director there and contacting one side of the negotiation, so that, I keep using the word negotiation, I'm not supposed to do that, the mediation, because you're supposed to be neutral, but you have to have an entry point. You have to be talking to one party or the other, I suspect, and then getting them to introduce the notion of having a third party mediation to the other party. But so again, at the local level for access and any conflict situations, I think contacting WFP's country director to see where they might need it at a local level. At a global level, I suspect maybe the best starting point is with MBBI. I think that's one of its mandates.
And that's Mediators Beyond Borders International, and they are starting a new international program. It's almost the top of the hour, 1 minute left. There are questions about Iraq. Real quickly here, how and what did you feed them, and how did that work that you could feed a whole country for as long as you were able to?
I'll try to answer this quickly. So with the first Gulf War, after it was over, the developed world and the United Nations forced Saddam Hussein to deposit all of his oil assets and money in a bank in Paris, and so that it would be used strictly for food, healthcare, and education in Iraq, that he wouldn't just spend it on what he wanted to spend it on. So that was called and so for 10 years, basically, all of the food, healthcare, and education resources were being provided, funneled through this program and paid for out of this bank. So basically before the second Gulf War, food was being provided by the government through this program. And so that's why they were, and healthcare. And that's why they were worried that if the government wasn't there, it would collapse. So the system was in place. They needed somebody to maintain it after the regime fell.
Thank you.
How we did it.
Oh, that's fascinating. Didn't even know that. That's fantastic. Thank you so much for being here today. It's just been an honor and a pleasure and a real expansion of the mind and the needs of the world. Thank you for all you do.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much. And thank you everybody for your donations. If you could let Natalie know of your contributions to whoever you give them to, whatever food bank, that would be wonderful. And have a wonderful week. We'll see you next week. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.